着重嘅。好啦，我哋嘅法定人数已经够啦。咁我哋今日嘅福利事务委员会特别会议咧，可以正式开始。今日嘅题目咧，今日我哋要特别会议嘅专门嘅题目咧，就系。
We have a quorum. Now I call to order the meeting of the panel on welfare services. And the item for discussion today is looking into the quality problem of private residential care homes for persons with disabilities in the light of the breach of Rehabilitation Company incident. I'd like to welcome the government representatives, deputations, public persons, and also the media. I know we are all very saddened by the incident, and that is why the response has been very enthusiastic. We have 66 deputations and individuals attending the meeting today. There will be two sessions. The first one is from now to 11:30, and the second one is 11:35 to 1:30 in the afternoon. Could I please ask every deputation or individual to make the best of the time given to you? Each of you will have 3 minutes. I'd like to remind the administration that time given to you will also be very tight. At the beginning of the meeting, I'll have 5 minutes for the secretary to introduce the paper. I'd like to remind deputations and the individuals attending the meeting, if you'd like to use the speaker and the earphone, please note that channel 1 is Cantonese, channel 2 is English, and channel 3 is Putonghua. And if you need any assistance, please contact our staff. There are many individuals and deputations coming. I will allow you to speak in the order of your applying to attend the meeting. But I also like to remind you that when you speak, you will not be covered or protected by the Legislative Council Powers and Privileges Ordinance Cap 382. At the same time, the submissions you supply are not covered or protected by the ordinance either. If deputations or individuals have not given submissions, please give a copy of your script to our staff or do so after the meeting. First, Secretary, Mr. Matthew Cheung, please. Chairman, Deputy Chairman, members, deputations and individuals attending the meeting. First, at the beginning, I'd like to say that we accord a high degree of concern towards this incident. The Bureau and the SWD will give comprehensive support to the 79 inmates at the breach of rehabilitation so that they can find appropriate placement. As of yesterday, 59 inmates have moved away from the breach of rehabilitation. Today, 9 will be moving, and the remaining 11 have also got appropriate arrangements. We will assist them. When they are in the new environment, 32 staff, including social workers of the SWD, will be providing continuous support to them and their families. After this incident, the department ourselves have been watching developments closely and have been communicating with the relevant bodies. And internally, we have reviewed the incident, and we would take this opportunity to comprehensively review the licensing system and the quality of homes to make sure that they are of a certain standard, and importantly, to see whether there is any room for improvement. Since we have supplied the paper only last night, maybe you have not had the time to read it. The paper is rather detailed. We would like to ascertain the exact contents of the paper before we wrote it, instead of writing just a bureaucratic paper. So if you look at the paper, you will see from para 11 or 12, we have listed 9 measures to bring in comprehensive improvement. We have identified the problem and we will target those problems. Number 1, we will enhance supervision and we'll step up enforcement. In a moment, the DSW and other staff will give you the details. What is important is that we are not going to tolerate or condone any substandard operation. This is important. As you know, some of the homes have a certificate of exemption. We will pay special attention to them, and we will give them a deadline that they have to achieve the standard within 3 years. Why is it that they are given a COE instead of a license? Because in terms of the building works or fire services installations, they need a grace period to bring them up to standard, but it doesn't mean that they can rest with a COE forever. And we'll also step up inspection. The department will be engaging retired law enforcement personnel, including the police, to help us do inspection because they have investigative experience. We'll also step up transparency. Say if we have issued warnings but the performance still not good, we will publicize the information, we'll put it on the internet. All these are concrete measures to follow up. And also, we will enhance the quality of home managers. We will require them to have certain qualification, and there may be an assessment system. Also, we'll step up training. You must provide training so you also allow the software to reach standards. And also, we'll go to all private homes, including those with COEs, to launch the quality service scheme. Social personnel will be able to visit these homes so that the service quality group scheme can be launched. We are going to increase manpower for the SWD as well. You knew that in the last term, and in the short term, we will apply for the creation of supernumerary post of Assistant Director of Social Welfare to do coordination of such homes. We'll follow up on that soon. And also, we will review the RCHD ordinance and the regulation. The first step is to, first of all, conduct administrative review and what administrative measures can be taken up as soon as possible. If rules and regulations have to be revised, we'll certainly do advance consultation with the stakeholders and the legal personnel. And also in terms of nurses, therapists, and frontline workers, we are going to increase manpower planning and supply. This is the series of measures. And also in the long term, many parents and other people are asking whether residential places will be increased. I can tell you that in the coming years, there will be quite a big number of residential places that will be provided. There are a few important projects. We will turn the ex-Siloam Hospital in Tuen Mun into the biggest integrated rehabilitation services complex. There will be 1,450 residential places, and 450 will be for severely mentally handicapped, and also 50 for the moderately mentally handicapped. Can I have one more minute? Yes, and also in the ex-Kainang Sheltered Workshop and Hostel in Kuntong, there will also be places for severely and moderately mentally handicapped. And we will also turn three primary schools into integrated welfare services centers. And there will be some in ex-CCC Kay Leung Primary School site in Tuen Mun, the ex-CCC Kay Cheng Primary School site in Fu Xin Estate in Tai Po, and also the ex-Sai Kung Central Primary School in Ho Chung Sai Kung. There will be RCHD places provided. And also in the future, there will also be thousands of rehabilitation services, including the special scheme on privately owned sites for welfare service users. There will be many places provided. All these are in Para 27. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Matthew Chung. Many deputations are here today, and I will remind you again, everyone will have 3 minutes. Since the first two deputations have not arrived, I will ask Mr. Lee, the third speaker, the Association of Parents of the Severely Mentally Handicapped. Thank you. The breach of rehabilitation incident exposes the severity of inadequacies of the regulations. We are very angry. We will reprimand the operator, and also the SWD has not done its work. There is a low requirement in terms of per capita space, and also in sections 15 and 16 of the RCHD ordinance, we are not represented at all. This is about inspections and also per capita space, and therefore there is no checks and balance from the stakeholders, and the operators have not been subject to the checking on previous sexual offenses. I think you have neglected the welfare of the inmates. All the incidents have been exposed only by parents and other people. And if copyrighted software is not properly installed, the operators should be subject to reprimand or law enforcement actions. Now, why is it that the operators do not have to take up responsibility if pirated software is used? Many parents, because they are not financially adequate, they may not be able to send these people to homes. And even in the schools provided for such children, there may not be hostels, so there is not adequate care for these people. And as you know, a 14-year-old became dead in the breach of rehabilitation. I believe there should be adequate hostels in schools so that children can be properly taken care of.
After these incidents, the license for breach of rehabilitation should be revoked. However, the government only distributed pamphlets instead of offering them services or even take over the care home. And the quality of such homes has always been very bad, and there's much room for improvement. The government's actions reflect their level of commitment. We hope that the government would act to reinstate confidence in the public. In light of recent incidents, the government must follow on them. First of all, they must set up a subcommittee for PWDs and meet their needs. And two, long-term planning must be conducted. And three, the RCHD ordinance must be revised, especially on persons with records of criminal or sexual crime convictions. And the employers have to take responsibility. If some care homes have their licenses revoked, the government should take over. And the families should also be able to monitor the homes. Thank you very much. Next up, Ms. Chen Hong Sao from the Hong Kong Social Workers Alliance. I will talk more about the breach of rehabilitation and how the government should take over. I want to talk about how more resources should be provided. The secretary said more nurses and support staff would be provided and the manpower ratio would be improved. And in the 2008 Code of Practice, the Social and Welfare Department slashed the manpower ratio. If you are trying to increase manpower, why did you decrease the manpower ratio at that time? And the ratio of carers has been slashed by about half. We used to have carers and nurses at the same time, but now we can only choose one. And some private homes are no longer required to have social workers. Would these affect the quality of services? I hope the secretary can explain more. The SWD has a service quality scheme in place. So measures are already in place to monitor private homes. I don't know why you find it so difficult. The inmates, families, and employees have the right to know, and they have the right to complaints. They should also know the manpower deployment situation. How can we ensure the well-being of the inmates? We have code of practice in place. And the government talked about increasing transparency. So how many notices or contraventions are required before you would revoke licenses? And we are not talking about whether the number of places is adequate. I know that there will be more places available. The issue is whether these places would be run by NGOs or subvented by the SWD. We can see that the subvented places are being privatized step by step, and operators can operate homes again under another name, even if their licenses are revoked. So I'd like to know the SWD's take on that. And a lot of people are forced to wait for private RCHE places. Are you trying to further privatize the services? And we have seen that the quality of many subvented homes is going down. There's a lack of manpower at a lot of subvented homes. The salaries are low and a lot of people are leaving, and all these would affect service quality. When help is sought, the SWD would say that these are privately run and they have no way to monitor them. These issues should be tackled. Thank you very much. So on one hand, the government said they are committed, but the deputations say otherwise. Ms. Zheng An, the Home Care Services Concern Alliance. Good morning. In different elderly or care homes, we have seen a series of incidents, and the SWD is well aware of that. We are very angry at the situation, and this is certainly unacceptable. We urge the government to tackle the issues. For elderly and PWD care, there are a lot of common requirements. Personal care is required, and rehab services are also required. For both the elderly and PWDs, they want to stay in a familiar neighborhood, and they want to be self-reliant under proper care instead of staying in a care home. The secretary said there would be 1,000 extra places at Siu Lam, but in such a condensed space, would it be a suitable home for the needy people? We should also provide community care. The provision of respite places would also help inmates and their parents, and that can help alleviate the pressure of carers. So we cannot ignore the importance of community care, but due to a lack of places, the queue for subvented care places is extremely long, and a lot of PWDs are forced to live in homes with certificates of exemption, and they have no choice. The PWDs and the elderly people have no choice at all, and they fall victim of the system. We cannot see any commitment from the government on long-term care. At the same time, the government is outsourcing its obligations to the market, and we have seen an improved board place scheme, and PWDs are asked to move into private care homes. For elderly care, vouchers are being introduced, and that's further sign that the services are being prioritized. However, this would affect the resources allocated. For PWDs, we have the same concern. We feel that the government should tackle or pay attention to the needs of the elderly and PWDs. A long-term care policy should be put in place, and more resources should be put into the care places, and they should not be discriminated because of age. The government should be more committed. Do PWDs actually require social or community care or residential home care? That's a question. And Mr. Lee from the SME International Alliance for Elderly and Rehab Services. And we have seen a number of incidents at residential homes, which is regrettable, but we have to continue. We cannot stop. That would be very irresponsible. Since the government started monitoring the homes in 2011, I have seen an increase or improvement in quality. Of course, there's further room for improvement. I believe that a lot of people in the industry are committed to serving the inmates. I also feel for them because I'm also a parent myself, and I understand their concerns. I'm a professional social worker. I represent a parents' alliance, and I'm also an operator of a care home. When we serve PWDs, we have always tried to improve service quality. And I can give an example of a case with a kid. We had a lot of meetings, and the kid's parents didn't want him to be admitted to a hospital. His mother told me that she's glad that I can live with my son, which is something taken for granted for many of us. But for children in these LCHDs, it's a very difficult thing. And I told her that we won't give up and we will do our best to send your child home. And now he's home for holiday. So our ultimate goal is for our children to go home. If the government's subvented homes can accommodate all PWDs, there would not be any need for private LCHDs. But that would not happen in the short time. And in the meantime, we still need these private homes. Given the circumstances, I hope you can offer us more comments and suggestions so that we can improve. Everything takes time. I hope you can give us some room and comments. We will be committed in providing social services. I hope you can trust private homes so that we can improve. If private homes are to be eliminated without a plan B, it would be it would not be appropriate, and the inmates would find it hard to adapt. So with the advancement in technology and communications, everything is already transparent, so I hope you can trust us. We'll do our best. Thank you, Mr. Lee. We want to hear from the trade, of course, so I hope perhaps you can raise your chin when you speak so we can see your face. Mr. Kuo-Ying Kin. The recent incident at Bridge of Rehabilitation is only the tip of an iceberg. And the government is the real culprit instead of the operators. The government encouraged privatization and the operation of private homes on a profit basis. And that's why we see these incidents at private homes. The inmates have become commodities and their family members are like consumers and they have no bargaining power. Even with privatization, the government can ensure service quality as long as they monitor such homes. But the situation is that the government is trying to save resources. They did not set stringent requirements on these homes, or else the operators would leave. The licensing regime cannot protect the interests of users. Since the RCHD ordinance was passed in June 2011, a licensing regime was introduced. The requirements on manpower and these homes were even more lax than the 2002 code of practice. The deep care home category was cancelled. and the carer ratio was less. On average, a carer has to take care of 30 inmates, and now the ratio became 60. And such ratio is inadequate in dealing with emergencies. In 2008, the SWD also withdrew the requirement of nurses in LCHDs. More than 270 LCHDs are holding a certificate of exemption. The Labour Party feels that the government should take over the bridge of rehabilitation, or else the inmates would just be suffering at another substandard home. There should be full subvention on LCHDs, and the government should also review the LCHD ordinance. Apart from hardware requirements, conditions must be set on manpower and manpower quality. And workers at the LCHDs must hold a certificate of no sexual crime conviction. And there should be nurses and social workers in these homes, and the general transparency should be enhanced. For incidents, they must be reported to the SWD and uploaded to the internet. Why was the requirement on manpower ratio and area revoked? Perhaps the government can explain that. Mr. Cheng Yi-Dek, I would go last because I'm still preparing my speech. Mr. Chow Tuck Hong, please. From the bridge of rehabilitation incident, we can see that the rights of PWDs is not being safeguarded. We are not being properly protected. We must have a third-party citizen advocate in order to safeguard our rights. The system is outdated and it's a complete failure. It only takes care of the demands of parents rather than the dignity of the people. Mr. Matthew Chang, the government should refer to the UN Convention on PWDs and provide proper community care. The failure of the education system means that we are never treated as individuals. We are not educated as proper adults. If that's the case, how can we learn different skills and secure dignity? We are whole persons. The system is unfair. We should not be treated as children anymore. And according to Article 12 of the UN Convention, we should be given proper rights. We should be given proper community care services. Your plans and the parents' plans do not represent our wishes. The society is full of discrimination, and we are deprived of our rights. When would the government follow the requirements of the UN Convention? A human rights committee must be set up as soon as possible to follow up on various issues. Human rights is safeguarded, should be safeguarded by law. We should revise or review the policy on mentally incapacitated persons. Apart from the participation of parents and professionals, the mentally handicapped people should also be involved. Thank you very much, Mr. Chow. I want to applaud you. You should the mentally handicapped should speak for themselves. Thank you very much for your views. Next, Mr. He Wai-man. My name is He Wai-man. In 2013, I was at a UN convention in Geneva to talk about rights for PWDs in Hong Kong. Recently, a youth leapt to his death in a private care home, and it was saddening. If support services to parents and carers should be enhanced, and if consultation can be offered or counseling can be offered to parents on how they can live with autistic youngsters, there's no need for them to enter homes, and we will not see any unnecessary deaths. Hong Kong's integrated and special education are only considering the medical aspect of the mentally handicapped. They never understand our behaviors. They force us to take psychiatric drugs, and if they cannot handle us, they would ask the parents to take us home. And we are being sent to homes or hospitals, and we are forced to leave our home to stay with strangers, and we cannot adapt, and our developments are affected.
This has violated the UN Convention on Children and People with Disabilities. When it comes to hostels, when we live there, we do not have dignity, we cannot have our own will, and if you have intellectual disability, you have lived there from 3 onwards, and from 21 onwards, you have to be relocated to large-scale health for adults. We don't know why. When the adults cannot take care of us, they would move us to hostels. We have no family lives. We are treated as kids all our lives. Some of us are forced into mental hospitals. And for private homes, they cannot take care of us. They ignore us, and some of them even abuse us. Please continue. Now, we need an evocation system. We hope that such a system can help parents to monitor subvented and private RCHDs. The governments should amend its ordinances, and the definition of PWDs and people with mental incapabilities should be redefined. The mode of service should be changed. Families should be helped. Caregivers should be supported. We want to live in the community. And a human rights committee, children's rights committee, should be set up so as to protect our rights. The relevant government policies should be reviewed. The most important thing is that a proper system should be set up for parents and children. We should have the right to know this is our matter, and we should take part in it. Thank you. Thank you, Mr. He Wai-man. I think you will forgive me for giving him more time, because I think it's great to hear from the self-proponents themselves, and they have another perspective of all the RCHDs, and they are human beings. I have heard you very clearly. Ms. Yip Man Ling, good morning. I'm speaking on behalf of Chester Nick Leung. I would like to talk about bridge of rehabilitation. Well, for residents, they should have the right to know. They should be given the opportunity to take a look at the new home, and they have to be assured that there will be enough people to take care of them in the new home, and the SWD would have to monitor the quality of private and subvented homes. SWD should take up the management of bridge of rehabilitation immediately, and it should make reference to the paragraph 21 and 22 of the report from the latest UN Convention on Children Conference. The whole report should be taken reference of, and there are conclusions as well as recommendations, so the government should look into them. And also, for CEDAW, they have already issued the 7th and 8th reports. You should also look at their recommendations. There should be a third proponent system. In accordance with the UN Convention on Disability, there are several proposals, and these are also the things that you should look into. The government should also provide funding for setting up a third proponent system. A Human Rights Committee should also be set up to take care of people with disabilities. PWDs are also human beings. They are adults, and they should be given the opportunity to take part in their own business. Yes, thank you for reminding us that China is one of the signatories of the relevant UN Convention. Next, Ms. Tin. Good morning. I'm a caregiver in a residential care home. My old boss once said this to me. He said that for SWD, it has a manpower ratio is 1 to 60. I've already given you one more person. So three carers are to take care of three stories, and I was told that we were given more manpower. So I would like to ask the director, when it comes to the code of practice for RCHD, what kind of standards are you using for setting the ratio? Now it is 1 to 60. If you're saying that I can just sit there and watch the 60 residents, yes, you have already achieved our goal, but that's impossible. These 60 people are human beings. They need care, and some of them need special care. So how can one person take care of 60 people? The bridge of rehabilitation incidents is just the tip of an iceberg. For subvented RDHDs, they are all using the lowest manpower ratio. So for private homes, you would know that there would be there is a very serious manpower shortage. The SWD should review the code of practice immediately, in particular, the manpower ratio. More manpower should be added. Don't just look at the ratio of 1 to something. You must look at the actual situation. Different homes have different needs, so manpower should be enhanced. Now, for a home with severely disabled people, from the morning to 3 p.m., 1 to 20. And if you change diaper for a person, you need 4 to 5 minutes. If you want to give him a bath, you need two carers, and we need 8 to 10 minutes. So please calculate. Each day, we have to change their diapers, we have to give them baths, and we'll take up most of our time. In the morning, we have to feed them breakfast. At lunch, we have to feed them meals. And we have other chores to do. For example, physiotherapy, occupational therapy, taking them to medical consultations. So have you calculated all these? Have you taken them into account? And after 3 p.m., the ratio is 1 to 40. At night, you have to change the diapers, you have to feed them again. And if residents suddenly have behavioral problems or psychological problems, then we have to take care of them more. So do we have the manpower to do that? We are all we have our hands full. And for subvented homes, is like this. For private homes, I think many of them are like the bridge of rehabilitation. They have a lot of problems. So the SWD should change the relevant rules as soon as possible. And also for the code of practice, you should change the manpower ratio. More residential places should be provided. More manpower and resources should be provided. You should penalize those homes with irregularities. Thank you. Now she asked the director, now the ratio is 1 to 60, so how can the residents be properly taken care of? Next, Mr. Chai Lam. Hip Hong Parents Association. Lately, we've heard of the breach of rehabilitation incident, and it's really staggering. We are parents. We have young children. And a lot of problems have been disclosed because of this incident. We as parents are saddened. We think the government has unshakable responsibility. In 2007, the Labour and Welfare Bureau issued a report on this, but for the past decade, there has been no new reports. The queues are waiting for homes are getting longer and longer, and there are only limited places. For persons with intellectual disability, they have to wait for more than 10 years before they can get a residential place. Some parents are getting old, so they are forced to put their children in private homes, but many of these homes are run by bad businessmen, and they only hire a small number of people. Very poor services are provided. The government's not penalizing them. Lately, we've had a breach of rehabilitation incident, and now this SWD suddenly tells us that it will revoke its license. But if the SWD has done a better inspection job, then their residents would be better off. Now some of them even died accidentally. So the monitoring of private homes should be enhanced. Inspection should be stepped up. You should review the quality and staff ratio of homes as much as possible. Are the staff qualified? And most importantly, you should talk to the residents and their parents, and if there are complaints, you should investigate vigorously. You should also issue warning and penalize the homes with irregularities. And also on the website, can you also disclose the list of homes with irregularities so that we can take reference from it? The government should review the present laws as soon as possible. You should plug the loopholes. Otherwise, unscrupulous people may continue to hurt these innocent residents. The government lacks the sincerity to shoulder the social responsibility. So the crux of the issue is to increase the number of subvented homes. By doing so, you will help many parents and children. Thank you, Monsieur. SWD has been condoning the unscrupulous operators. I think the director will answer you later. Mr. Liang Sak-Lun. Hong Kong Federation of Women's Centers. We are very concerned about this kind of issues. Homes are very important for certain residents, and homes should ensure the safety of residents. We are very angry about the breach of rehabilitation incident. Hong Kong is a part of the CEDAW agreement, and men and women should be given equal rights and opportunities, and there should be no discrimination. And for all the signatories, they should adopt measures to protect their women. They include laws, remedies, so as to ensure that they can protect their women against violence, sexual harassment, etc. So we hope that the Hong Kong government and the SWD would implement the requirements of the CEDAW immediately. And also for the breach of rehabilitation incident, we have the following to say. First of all, a task force should be set up. put together a long-term planning for rehabilitation. Now we do not have enough RCHDs, and now it's becoming more marketized, and also for PWD carers, either they would have to spend all their time taking care of the PWDs, or they would have to send the PWDs into homes. So we hope that the government would reserve space in newly developed areas for building RCHDs. And also the RCHD system should be reformed. RCHDs should be in the form of small homes so that PWDs can be taken care of in a better manner. And also a better support policy should be provided. Now many of the homes are of poor quality, and some of the residents are even endangered. When the RCHD's licenses are revoked, the residents don't know what to do, and the operators are not penalized. So we want the SWD to take up its responsibility. It should apologize to the public. It should also take up the management of the breach of rehabilitation so that residents can be properly taken care of. And also, the government should enhance education when it comes to gender. The UN is very concerned about women and girls' condition in Hong Kong, so better sex education should be given to the PWDs, and also for law enforcement agents, more proper training should be given. For people working at homes, they should have a clear record of sex offense. Thank you, Mr. Leung. I cannot see your badge, could you move it? I cannot see your poster. Thank you. Mr. Kwok Chun Chin. So cool. Well, for the breach of rehabilitation incident, I think it reflects the problems concerning private homes in terms of monitoring quality, etc. The root of the problem is the insufficiency of private homes. Now, persons with intellectual disability would have to wait for 10 years before he can get a place in a subvented home. So the parents have no choice. They have to choose private homes. Now, the breach of rehabilitation license has been revoked. But we are also concerned about other private homes. Maybe some of them are just like the breach of rehabilitation. So we are very worried. Our organization wants to put the following views forward. First of all, the government should start planning for rehabilitation as soon as possible. You have to ensure that there are enough homes. And second, the RCHD ordinance should be amended. The staff arrangement per capita floor space, etc., should be improved. And also for the managers of homes, you should have a more stringent requirements. For the staff of homes, you should check their records whether they have sexual offense convictions or not. We have to ensure that residents would not be harmed. An independent committee should be set up. Representatives of parents and residents should be sitting on the committee. They should be responsible for the licensing and renewal of license for homes. And also the inspection records of RCHDs should be made public. We want to know whether letters of warnings have been issued to them and whether there are even deaths in certain homes. And also for unnatural death cases, for example, if a number of such cases happen in a certain home, the police should carry out criminal investigation, and also relevant penalty should be imposed. For PWDs who are living in private homes, case management service should be provided. When there is a need, appropriate services should be provided. Many residents are now paying their home fees by CSSA. However, their families cannot top up the payment so as to provide better services to residents. We hope that this kind of system can be relaxed, and also the charging system of private homes should be monitored. Now, many homes are operating on certificates of exemption. I hope the government would speed up the lottery fund application procedure. Oh, can you think about that? Setting up an independent committee so that representatives of parents and PWDs can also sit on this committee. Next, Mr. Tam Wai Yip. A care group for mentally handicapped. We hope that the SWD would come up with concrete plans so as to improve our CHDs. However, up to now, you have told us that you would follow up on issues, but we don't think you are doing it properly. Now, you have revoked the license of the Bridge of Rehabilitation. You have arranged for the residents to move out, and then you think the case is closed. However, for some of the residents, after they are moved to other homes, they cannot be taken care of properly, and that's one incident that a resident has had a serious sunburns, and some of the residents have run away. So you are just moving the residents from one hell to another hell. You haven't treated them as human beings. So we strongly request the SWD and the LWB to apologize to the affected residents and their parents, and you should shoulder the responsibility of not having enough monitoring of homes. You should take up the management of the Bridge of Rehabilitation so that the residents would not have to get accustomed to a new environment, and you should immediately set up an RCHD reform committee. You should invite different stakeholders to join the committee.
Okay,
there should be a comprehensive review of the RCHD ordinance, the licensing system, and also requirements about the operator. You must also manage the operating environment of the homes and also report back to LegCo about the findings of your investigation. And the administration must give up the building of castle-like homes, and in all private and public new housing estates, there must be the reservation of units, be it on a small scale, in order to tackle the inadequacy of homes problem. I remember Ms. Yip on the 22nd of October, the DSW, said this when she met us. She said, this is for the welfare of the inmates. I'd like to ask you, when you enacted the RCHD ordinance, did you have in mind what we actually needed? I'm here at the hearing today because I want to tell you that mentally handicapped people have the right to choose our own lifestyle and protect our dignity. We expect the SWD, the LW Bureau, to grasp the opportunity and come up with actual means to return dignity to us. Thank you, Mr. Tam. A very heavy accusation from hell to hell. Mr. Yip, sorry, I missed you out. Mr. Yip K. Chen. Mr. Chang Kin Hwa has got over $10 million from the Bridge of Rehabilitation Company, but he doesn't engage enough staff to serve the inmates. He has milked the mentally handicapped. He has abused the MH physically. He is scum of the earth. He is also a poisonous snake. Why is it that he has not been arrested and removed? The MH need protection. They need love and care, and people with a sense of mission to take care of them. You should not view them as a tool for making a profit. The RCHD ordinance and the code of practice are too lax in their requirements. and the enforcement has been proven to be insufficient from this incident, and there is not enough protection for the MH. This is very angering. The SWD has the responsibility to amend the law immediately to improve the quality of homes. When there are irregularities, there must be penalties. The licensee should be penalized so as to put an end to negligence and abuse cases. The SWD should reassure parents, and please do not let us live in fear. MH people need love and care. They need to be taken care of by professionals. If you are selfish, you can't help the MH. The government should train personnel and every year, there must be assessment done on the homes and staff. There should be reward for those who contribute to society and those who continue to enhance the quality of their service. Mr. Matthew Cheng, the SLW, there are tragedies happening. Do you have love and care towards the MH? We asked many times that there should be a council on services for MH. And the council would be able to monitor the system and the quality of service. Please, Harry, if you are loving towards the MH, you can certainly do it. But if you are prejudiced, you will not be able to do it. Now, the Grace Parent Association asks you to help us set up this council so that you are accountable to us. Thank you. Thank you very much. Secretary, you may not need to respond whether you have a loving heart. It's very personal. Just respond whether you have commitment. And maybe the Director of Public Prosecution can also respond. Ms. Choi Hiu-Ching from the Association of Exempted Homes. Thank you, Chairman. The breach of rehabilitation incident has been reported many times and is described as a limbo. And it is said that it is making the biggest profit and abusing the MH. Our association would like to express regret, but we cannot subscribe to those accusations in the media, because this is unfair to those who put their heart in the business. Recently, there are people say there should be zero homes. They say that subsidized homes should take the place of private homes. I hope there will be enough space in Hong Kong one day to do this, but this cannot be achieved within a short period. That goes to show that private homes are still needed. Before MH people have a home in a subsidized home, then the private homes will mean temporary shelter for them. I have been in the business for over 10 years, and I have seen for myself that some inmates have been given a place in a public home, but they have chosen to remain in a private home because they have got friends there and they have a good relationship with the staff there. And I have seen that when a relative of an inmate was dying, he or she asked a private home to take care of the inmate. So there is a sense of belonging, and even the relatives have confidence in the performance of private homes. All in all, we sincerely hope the public will not just concentrate on the breach of rehabilitation incident and think that private homes are for no good. Actually, most of the staff are working diligently, and please let us have some time and space so we can work to improve and achieve licensing requirements so we can continue to contribute to society and serve the parents and the inmates. Thank you, Ms. Choi. From the Certificate of Exemption of Residential Care Home for Rehabilitation Services Association. Next, Mr. Wong from an association for the Eastern District. Thank you, Chairman and members. My impression is that this panel has the biggest membership from both the pro-establishment and the democratic camp. I thank you for showing your concern towards us. I'd like to quote the behavior of certain members. I hope you will follow those examples. Like Dr. Fernando Zheng, he has actually visited homes for the elderly, so he knows the problems. If you don't go, how can you know how they operate? I also thank Mr. Elvin Yang. He knows what is meant by one in seven, meaning that there is an elderly person in every seven persons in Hong Kong. I also voted because I have a vote. I hope both the camps in the LegCo will know that we elderly people also cast votes. I also thank Mr. Roy Kwong. He cares very much for the young, and he wants to allow the young to know the difficulties faced by the elderly, like using a mobile phone. I hope he will continue to do that. Also, Mr. Xiu Ka-chun, the chairman, in the past 1 or 2 months, he has shown a lot of concern towards suicides committed by young people. Many people did not pay a lot of attention, but he has been talking to young people. And also, Ms. Lau Siu Lai, she always visits the community. She is always contacting grassroots. I hope you will follow these examples. And number six, I hope both camps of LegCo will think about the requirements and rights of service users. Please talk to us more. We will let you know our difficulties. And now, on behalf of this association in the Eastern District, I'd like to put forward some requirements for the consideration of the Bureau. Just now, someone said that the incident is just the tip of an iceberg. We will not be so high-sounding. We'll just say that this is not an isolated incident, but this happens all the time. I have been to Sham Shui Po, just like Dr. Fernando Zheng. I've been to Sham Shui Po, North Point, and Chai Wan to look at the homes for the elderly. I know that there are staff who actually are inmates. And also, what is special is that they collect the inmates' identity cards. Does it mean that the inmates are not allowed to go out, or why? Suffice it to say that this shows that inmates cannot leave the homes. There is inadequate manpower. And secondly, we hope the administration will not contract out all its services. Number three, we hope the administration will step up supervision of these homes, and please also engage parents and service users in the supervision. Thank you. Lastly, number four, we hope the administration will communicate more with the service users. I hope counselors will also communicate more with service users. Thank you, Mr. Wong. I think the both camps are united in serving the MH. We are all very sad about the incident. Many members have signed up to attend the meeting. Be assured about that. Ms. Chen from the Home for Certificate of Exemption of Residential Care Home for Rehabilitation Service Association from the NT. Well, you always say the quality of service is bad, but do you know why? In the industry, we know that it's a resource problem. Whether you have academic qualification or whether you're of a certain age, no one wants to join the industry because this is an obnoxious trade. It's a trade with long hours, and you need a big, loving heart to go into the industry. We also have a poor reputation. Even if we find somebody appropriate and we train them, they will go to a subsidized organization afterwards. It's very difficult to recruit people. Take my own home, for example. We serve the MH. Many of them are moderately or only mildly handicapped. However, they cannot take care of themselves. and we need to attend to the details of their daily lives, and they need help with bathing, eating, and some of them have incontinence problems, and therefore we need manpower to provide good service. We always have recruitment notices put up at the Labor Department throughout the year, but people won't even call up, not to mention coming for an interview. People say we pay a low salary, but even if we provide good conditions of service, we cannot compare with subsidized organizations and the HA. What can we do if we cannot hire from Hong Kong? We have to apply for imported labor. But it's not that whatever we want will be supplied. Sometimes the LAB would think that we already have a good enough contingent of imported labor, we will not be granted what we want. The process also takes long. At least you wait a year before someone can come to work from outside Hong Kong. When the contract expires, it is not allowed to be renewed. So what can we do? How can we improve our services? If we have more manpower, the hygiene, the physical and mental well-being of the inmates will all be better, and it will be a win-win situation. We support the navigation schemes for young people to encourage young people to join the industry. But what is the effect? Today, we still want to improve the quality of service and help inmates to be rehabilitated, but we don't have resources. I hope the administration will give us a hand so we can provide better service for the disadvantaged. Thank you. Thank you very much, Ms. Chan. The quality of homes that can be traced to manpower problem. And thank you for reminding us. And what is the effect of the navigation scheme for young persons in care services? We want to know. Next, we have Pastor Leung. Good morning. I'm here in my capacity as a pastor of the church. Let me share with you the principles of our church, and I'm from the Christian Blessed Charity Church Limited. We want to serve people and families who need us. We receive the instructions of Jesus Christ. Man matters most. The Bible says God loves us. We operate a rehabilitation center, so MH people or who are disabled or who are emotionally disturbed and who are chronically ill can come to our homes, and we give them this feeling of home and comprehensive care. Under the guidance of God, inmates will be encouraged, they will be appreciated, and they will be recognized. We also help them to be able to have self-care, and we also want them to be loving and caring among themselves. We will call upon them to love one another, and the staff all share the same mission. Whatever the character or behavior of inmates, they are loved by God, because God never abandoned us. He walks with us. He allows us to influence others with our good example. Inmates and their parents face different kinds of pressure because of deterioration of physical fitness, because of financial incapabilities and lack of family care. They still need hope, and they also have the right to want a happy life. We want to give them refuge. And it is said by a famous person that in today's culture, there is only trading, and to love and to be loved, there are always conditions. And very often, these people are regarded as useless in society and do not deserve love. But then, exactly these people, they need unconditional love. Our church follows the teachings of Christ. The Bible reminds us that you need to apply all your energy to love. This is the biggest instruction. And also, you should love others as you would love yourselves. I have experienced the unconditional love of God. Inmates need to be recognized, cared for, and accepted. They should be cared for both physically and mentally. Thank you, Pastor Leung. Next, Mr. Chung Kim Kong from the Social Workers Alliance of Private Homes. Thank you. I'd like to share with you my own experience. In the 80s, before there was a standard manpower requirement for halfway houses, I started to be a social worker. We need to take care of the daily living of the inmates. I also need to wash the toilets and make meals. And then afterwards, it was said that there should be 11 social workers serving 40 inmates. Then I was able to work really as a social worker. So I was happy. And at that stage, the quality of service was starting to be enhanced. But then in the mid-90s, it was fortunate that I was able to work in a public housing at state home for the moderately mentally handicapped. The in charge told us that, in fact, the administration would not continue to plow resources into such homes. And the increase in new places will be stagnated. At that time, we could see that private homes are mushrooming. In the center that I worked, very often there would be new inmates coming in, and they would need to go through a so-called trial period. They would have to perform well in order to stay. And my supervisor was questioning my decisions about the staying or otherwise of inmates. He said that I was too lenient and in allowing the inmates to live there permanently.
If those inmates are serious, then I know that a lot of them have emotional or mental issues, and these are issues we have to tackle. I might not have been very capable, so very often we could not help the inmates with their mental problems. However, we still hope that they can live happily in our homes. After I left the institution, I visited some private LCHDs. I met some inmates, which I used to admit. I had a lot of admiration for the operator at that time. At a care home for the moderately mentally handicapped, we had 15 staff, including 2 nurses. And even that, we found it very hard to operate. But the private homes were doing very well. At the latter stages, the inmates had to leave after 2 years, and subsequently a lot of them were admitted into private homes. So you can see that private homes play final gatekeeper, and they have to deal with all kinds of problems with the inmates. I hope the public can offer us more support and confidence, but this is certainly a great challenge. We will certainly work very hard, but I hope the public can have more trust in us so that we can serve you better. Thank you. Thank you very much. Mr. Cheng Pingyun from the Association for the Rehab of Private Homes. First of all, I'd like to thank the panel on welfare services for giving us the chance to speak. This is a very sad lesson and experience for all of us. For the public, PWDs, as well as service operators, This is a lesson to learn. After the incident, our members have been paying close attention, and we have met a number of times. We reviewed the cause of the incident, the short and long-term solutions, the support that we can offer, etc. Since our establishment, we have stuck with the same objectives, which include uniting the trade and fighting for the best interests of users and operators. We want to facilitate communication and enhance exchanges in order to raise quality. We want to collect different views on rehab policy, and we want to voice our views to the government. In the incident, we issued a statement to parent associations and legislators, including Mr. Roy Kwong, and I'd like to repeat the content on the statement. We acknowledge calls for improvement of quality in private homes. We agree that the record of no criminal or sexual criminal conviction is important. We want to secure resources so that our members can provide more information on no sexual crime conviction. And we also remind members that when dealing with female inmates, at least two staff members must be present, and at least one of them must be female. For male staff, they can only go on duty in male wards. In order to enhance service quality, we recommend our members to join standard certification courses. So we are talking about objective third-party service standards. Can I be given more time, since time is limited? Can you wrap up, please? We maintain an open stance in responding to reasonable calls and requests from the public. The goal is to enhance service quality in private homes. Thank you very much, Ms. Lam Chan. Thank you. I'm from the Lok Yan Parent Association. The Bridge of Rehabilitation incident is only the tip of the iceberg. The current policy cannot protect the mentally handicapped, and enforcement is also inadequate. The Bridge of Rehabilitation has a severe lack of manpower, and it made up fake rosters, and a mentally handicapped child fell to his death, and no one actually cared. You only issued warnings, but they weren't penalized. You know that private homes are not properly operated, but then you keep encouraging the mentally handicapped to join. They are not treated as individuals. We saw death after death, and you're still boasting about regular inspections. How can you effectively regulate private homes? I can tell the SWD that the parents are very disappointed. The SWD is only helping the unscrupulous operators. And the SWD is putting lives at risk. The government must set up a working group to review the RCHD ordinance and clarify the matter at LegCo. At the same time, the SWD must be held accountable and apologize to the mentally handicapped, they should also take over the bridge of rehabilitation and take care of its inmates. Thank you. Secretary, she is very famous in the circle of the mentally handicapped, so I hope you can address her questions. Ms. Cheng Yitik from the Frontline Workers Association in 2011. The SWD conducted an inspection of all private homes or private care homes. 3 years later, 90% of the homes were substandard. The SWD no longer monitored them, and they even relaxed the requirements, and that's why we see this breach of rehabilitation incident. I'd like to know whether the government is treating our elderly people as commodities instead of individuals. The inspections were very lax. One of our members told us that there were a person choked to his death at the bridge of rehabilitation. And the government is always telling us that they are doing something. And sometimes even subvented homes are problematic. And that is thanks to the one-off funding. And the government's practices are affecting the quality of our services. The people are treated as animals, and the staff are treated like robots, and they have to work nonstop. So how can they be sympathetic under the circumstances? Do you know how much heart we have to put into the inmates? So you are maltreating the staff at the residential homes. The people are not treated as persons. This is infuriating. When you speak, please focus on the incident. Mr. Ng Wai Chiu, Christian social workers. I want to talk about two issues. First, the incident at Bridge of Rehabilitation is not an isolated incident, and two, the government must apologize. That's the only way things can change. And earlier this year, Tsingtao reported on an incident at Cambridge Care Home and at Ngautau Kok, and the anus and guts of an inmate was full of cotton, and the inmate subsequently died at another residential care home, according to HA01. The inmate was strapped to the bed and toilet basin, and the inmate was burned. And in another incident, the care home fee was raised 5 times a year, and the meals provided were substandard. And some cases involved community care. A mentally handicapped person stayed with the dead body of their parent for a number of days. So a lot of parents were reluctant to send their family members to private homes because of these incidents, but the queue for private or subvented homes is extremely long. In the 1990s, we have heard news of tortures at private homes. Last year, at the Cambridge Care Home, an elderly person had to take a shower naked. Matthew Cheng, you cannot ignore these scandals. If the victims were your family, what are you going to do? Are you going to ignore them? Are you going to let those private homes continue. The lack of care for the elderly and PWDs is appalling. It's time that you face the consequences. First of all, you must apologize to the PWDs and their families in order to show the government's commitment. And a new bureau should be set up. You should stop the privatization, and you should enhance the manpower ratio. And you must retain the talents. That's all. Thank you. I'd like to add something. Mr. Matthew Chung requested to attend this hearing today. I'd just like to make this point. Ms. Choi Su-hwa, the concerned group towards violence on women. Thank you. My name is Choi. A lot of deputations talked about the care home, so I won't repeat what they said. I'd like to talk about the prevention of sexual violence in elderly in care homes. And at the Bridge of Rehabilitation, there was an incident of sexual abuse. The public could see that there are a lot of issues at private homes. As the regulator, the SWD, said, they made a lot of inspections on Bridge of Rehabilitation. However, the problems were not rectified, and yet they were granted a certificate of exemption every year. So it's a mishap on the SWD's part. So the SWD should apologize to the victims and their families. In the existing LCHD, well, we feel that the LCHD ordinance must be reviewed. The licensing conditions should incorporate a mechanism against sexual violence, and the government must make it mandatory. The care homes should have preventative measures in their policy, in their complaints mechanism, and staff training in the prevention of sexual crimes. When granting a license, both frontline workers and the backgrounds of its directors and staff members should be checked. People who are involved in sexual crimes or violence should be able to take care of PWDs. For incidents involving sexual abuse, the people involved should be criminally liable, and this should be included in the LCHD ordinance. Right now, there's no mandation on social workers in these homes, and this should be introduced as well. Guidelines should be made available on against sexual violence, and the victim has already given evidence. Has the SWD ever convened an interdisciplinary meeting? Has advice been sought? And did any officer follow up on the victim and their family? The SWD must explain all these issues. Cases of sexual violence are more serious than other cases. For ordinary people, facing sexual violence is hard enough, and it's even harder for PWDs. We hope that the government should provide more support to the mentally handicapped. Ms. Chang Lai Mui, thank you. Private homes have to consider profit. Doing business or making profit and taking care of inmates are two polar opposites. I urge the government to stop or cancel the privatization of homes then they should revoke the voucher scheme. For subvented and government care homes, well, we should make a very clear distinguishment between the two. Since the government implemented one-off funding, the service quality has been going downhill. The government should review whether this policy should be retained. They should also learn from the Netherlands, Taiwan, and the United States. They should begin with urban planning and the buildings ordinance. They should create favorable conditions for care homes. I agree with an earlier deputation who suggested the government to reserve certain floors or units in public housing units so that families with PWDs can move in and the government can provide community support. This can create a friendly neighborhood and offer better support and alleviate the burden on frontline workers. This can also foster a neighborhood spirit. When we look at the current care homes, we must enhance the manpower ratio, so I won't repeat what others have already said. Without long-term goal and planning, we can never meet our goals. Unfortunately, these qualities are lacking in our social welfare policy. In the past decade, both NGOs and the public have spoken at the lack of support at residential care homes, and there's a lack of supervision. However, the government refuses to deal with these issues despite having a lot of resources.
Interdepartmental groups should be set up and 10-year rehabilitation plans should be mapped out. Thank you for your suggestion, and you have talked about the advantages of home-like hostels. I think that's very good. Thanks. We have Ms. Yim. Ms. Yim, thank you. I speak on behalf of the parents of Down syndrome children. With regard to the breach of rehabilitation incident, we are very angry and sad. But we would like to thank the government for responding to this in a proactive manner. The SWD cannot shirk its responsibility. For this incident, we think that prosecution must be reinstituted because this is damaging to public interest. We ask the relevant government departments to be more concerned about this matter. I am the parent of a person with intellectual disability. We are very concerned about them. However, even for ordinary people, they may become MIP if they are injured or if they are seriously ill. So this is not a one-off incident. And there are evidences. Even for torturing cats and dogs, you would sue the culprits. So for this incident, how come you are not doing anything? How come the MIPs are even more inferior than cats and dogs? There are loops, there are loopholes in the law. You cannot connive at these people. We hope that private homes can be monitored more stringently. As for the bot place scheme, you should also step up your regulation, otherwise you will become an accomplice. We parents are under huge pressure. We have to put our children in our CHDs. However, the exemption system has been renewed 3 years after another 3 years. As a parent, as a caregiver, I think this is fatal to our children. you are condoning such incidents. If the government wants to buy residential places, why don't you buy up the whole home? Then you can really take care of the PWDs. We parents do not want large-scale homes like prisons. We think different people need different types of homes. We hope that there can be smaller-scale homes and residential care homes which are more like families. Even on the mainland, there are successful examples. I think you should really look into them. Thank you. Ms. Yun Fong Kyu. Now, we have Mr. Kwong Tai, who is from Chang Kwan O Elderly Livelihood Concern Group. Good morning. First of all, the government should shoulder the responsibility for taking care of the elderly and PWDs, and you should not just pass the buck to the market. Because in the market, homes are of different qualities and people cannot have confidence in them. There are some good homes in the market, so the government should shoulder the responsibility. It should not encourage users to go to private homes. The government has a lot of money, and it has a huge surplus every year. So that's why it has a lot of reserve. With this huge reserve, the government would have more than enough resources to solve the R60 problem. We have three suggestions to make. First, the government should spend public money properly. The R60 voucher scheme should be shelved. Second, you should review RCHE and RCHD ordinances as soon as possible. Their code of practices, codes of practice should also be reviewed. The staffing arrangements, per capita floor space, etc., should be improved. You should step up your monitoring of the homes so that these homes can really make improvements. And thirdly, you shouldn't build large-scale homes. Smaller homestyle hostels should be set up so that the users can enjoy a better life. This is what I want to say. Thank you, Chairman. Thank you, Mr. Kwong. 27 deputations and individuals have spoken in this first session, so now I would like to ask the government to respond. Director, Secretary, 5 minutes. I would like to thank the 20-odd deputations and individuals their views. I will speak for 3 minutes and then I'll ask the director to supplement. First of all, about some big issues. Many of the representatives asked us to restart the 10-year rehabilitation plan. 10 years ago, we have conducted a number of studies, and actually every year we renew the relevant measures. In the second quarter of next year, now we are conducting a consultation, and after the consultation, we will start working on the rehabilitation policy. So in the second quarter of next year, we will start a review. That is very clear. And second, some deputations have some misunderstandings. Now, we are talking about the year 2021, and by then, we will have several more thousand places. Now, some of you don't want to see castle-like homes. Well, for Siulam, it's a big site. It's an area of 3.5 hectares. We are not building buildings. We are building low rises. It's a very beautiful and quiet place where rehabilitation trainings can also be provided. There are hundreds of rehabilitation places. So it's not like a castle and it's not like a resettlement housing. So it's a very good environment for rehabilitation. You don't have to be worried. And also when it comes to planning, we are also planning for medium scale homes. They will be in new development areas in new towns. So I understand your demand. Some of you also hope that the staff can get a certificate of no sexual offense. In our paper, we have listed 9 directions, and one of them is to ensure the well-being of PWD. So we will take it into consideration. And another issue is about manpower. We are also very concerned about that. In the past few years, we have been doing a lot to achieve this goal. For example, we have a scheme for young people, which is called Qualification Scheme for Young Persons in Care Services, and about 400 young people have now joined this industry. We still have 600 places which will be launched in the coming 2 years. As for middle-aged women, we also hope to attract housewives to join our programs. We will provide them with employment training. The employment retraining board will be responsible for that. So this is about the big issues. I will now hand over the floor to the director. Thank you. I would like to thank the deputations for giving us their opinions. Just now, many of you asked this question. That is, after putting together the ordinance and the code of practice, how come the manpower ratio has dropped? Well, actually, before the legislation, we mainly monitored, subvented our CHDs, and after that, we thought that we should also monitor private our CHDs. We consulted all the stakeholders at that time. We have looked at the actual operation of the RCHDs, and then we put together the relevant rules and code of practice. This is applicable to all the RCHDs, including subvented and private. And we have also launched a bot place scheme. Just now, some of you have mentioned the 16SQS. So they are also applicable to the private RCHDs. Of course, we know that there is room for improvements. We will make a review. And some other deputations mentioned this. That is, when it comes to law enforcement and monitoring by the SWD, whether we should make improvements. Well, I would like to assure you that we will not condone homes with irregularities, and we will enforce the law. In the documents, we have put forward a number of recommendations. When we receive complaints, our licensing office will immediately follow up. We will have a new direction. That is, we will set up more smaller teams so that law enforcement can be more efficient. And also, we will invite retired discipline service officers to join us because they have professional skills in investigation. And when it comes to staff's working experience and record and staff's shift rosters, etc., we'll also follow up on that. Please be as fast as possible. And thirdly, when it comes to managers of homes, you hope that they can be held accountable. Yes, this is one of the directions we are considering. Maybe we can set up requirements concerning the directors or managers' qualifications. And also for service users and parents, they are welcome to join our monitoring program. And also we are considering making public the records of homes. We have a homes service quality group, and we will be inviting families of residents to join. We'll also set up other platforms so that we can listen to more opinions. We are now trying to find ways to disclose the records of homes. By doing so, we hope that the transparency can be enhanced. So from the DOJ, I think we will hear your answer later. Well, maybe we can extend this session to 11:35. Now I would allow members to ask questions. Seven members have raised their hands. Let me first invite three members. Owen Young, Fernando Chung, and another member. What? Second session? Can I also ask my question? In this session, we don't have enough time. Well, maybe members can shorten their questions because I want to express my views when the deputations are here. Yes, I'll try my best. Please ask your questions within 2 to 3 minutes. I'll finish your questions within 2 to 3 minutes. Let's all ask short questions so that we can all express our views within this session. Fernando Chung, Leung Yu Chung, Evan Yang, Pun Siu Peng, Lam Chuk Ting, and Wu Chi Wai, as well as Michael Chen, and Mr. Chen Chichin, and Holden Chow. Okay, let's restrict our questions to 1 to 2 minutes. Dr. Fernando Chung, I will be moving a motion with Mr. Leung Yu Chung. I hope that this can be handled before the end of this session. Chairman, 2 minutes. I really don't know how I can express my anger within 2 minutes. For the breach of rehabilitation incident is definitely only the tip of an iceberg. This is a huge iceberg. This has been a problem for many years. We have ignored the residential care for PWDs and the elderly. In 2007, the code of practice requirements were even more stringent, and it's disclosed by Ming Pao that in 1998, at that time we had an RPP, and the requirements were much more stringent. The manpower requirement was 5 times that of today. 5 times, Chairman. The Secretary is sitting here. It's he who did it. The requirements dropped during his term. And for some behaviors, you don't need to have bad intention, but with such behaviors, you can still harm people seriously. Ignorance, negligence, lack of care. You are indeed killing people. I don't understand how come the secretary still has face sitting here, facing the families of the LCHD residents. In your hands, our system has deteriorated. We have now seen many incidents of sexual abuse and even death. So, Secretary, do you think you are derelict of duty? Leung Yu Chung, I would like to thank the deputations for coming here today. We have seen a number of unfortunate incidents lately. I think the government cannot shirk its responsibility. It should bear its responsibility. And when we come to the monitoring of homes, the amendment of laws, etc., I think they are really backward. They cannot meet the needs of society. In the past years, I can't say the government has turned a blind eye or a deaf ear to all this. However, we have been talking about this problem for many years. We want you to strengthen the law. We want more manpower. We want you to step up inspections. On the surface, it seems that you have done something. However, the reality is not proving that. So it seems that It seems that you have tried to make improvement in a number of areas. However, have you really solved the problems? We don't believe you. You have new policies, but there are no indicators. You say that you will increase the number of homes, but how many? You haven't told us. Will you meet the needs of society? You haven't told us. How about manpower? Will it be increased? You haven't told us. It seems that you have given us your homework today, but I don't think your homework is completed. I don't think you are responding soundly to this incident. I really regret this. You are just telling us abstract directions. We do not hear concrete plans. Secretary, can you set indicators so that all the existing problems can be fixed? Next, Mr. Alvin Young. Thank you, Chairman. I totally support Dr. Fernando Cheung's motion. We think that the government should face this problem squarely. An interdepartmental committee should be set up to address the aspirations of people. Just now, the two members have pointed out the major problems, and I would like to respond to some of the points made by deputations. The government should respond to them as fast as possible. First, for the exemption mechanism, the breach of rehabilitation incident has disclosed a huge loophole in the mechanism. A lot of homes are operating under the exemption system. Can the director tell us what the standards and criteria are for these exempted homes? How can you ensure that they would not repeat the mistake made by the breach of rehabilitation? How can you ensure that these homes can be run properly so that users can feel assured? And secondly, in the short term, will the government do this? That is, the homes conditions should be made more transparent.
As was said, if the home managers are complained against or if they have a conviction record, whether it be the home or the home manager, I think the information should be disclosed for the users to know. I know we need to emphasize privacy. We don't need the names, but if there is such a record about the management, then at least you should make an indication so the users will make an informed choice. I think that would afford some great protection, and we don't need any legislative requirements to do this. Thank you, Mr. Young. Mr. Pun Xiuping. Thank you. I thank the deputations for coming. I have only 2 minutes. I'd like to ask some questions. Number one, the progress of licensing. In the 5 years, there are still 200-odd homes which are exempted. In paragraph 7 of the paper, it is said that within 3 years, hopefully all the homes can be licensed. Can I get more accurate information? The Bureau says the exemption arrangement is such that, you know, the law has been with us for 5 years. Are you telling us that within the next 3 years you are going to tackle all these homes with COEs? Secondly, inspection. You are going to hire retired discipline services, but in the past you already conducted thousands of inspections without any prosecution. If you have retired, experienced, and disciplinary staff, does it mean that you'll be able to take out prosecutions? Can we have short replies? I'll start with the last question. First, I think you're all concerned about licensing. The paper sets a timetable of 3 years. We're going to help the homes, most of them are subsidized, to get licenses. Only 40 of them are private homes. Very often, they do not meet the standard in terms of the compartmentalization, the building services or fire services escapes. They need to submit building plans. And if you are in a rural area, you even need more permission. We are going to shorten
the period of approval to help them. And we also help them with resources if they have a funding problem. We have already got approval that about 90% of the funding can come from the lotteries fund. Number three, technical support. The Productivity Council will be giving them expert advice. And if they still do not achieve the criteria in 3 years, they will have to wind up. This has been said in the paper already. Mr. Lam Chak Ting. Thank you, Chair. I'd like to tell the Bureau that first you had Cambridge, and then you have the breach of rehabilitation, you have abuse of the elderly, and then there are abnormal deaths. All these are very serious incidents. There may be a personal integrity problem involved, but then more importantly, it is the system. Like what Mr. Ng said, he listed a whole series of incidents. The breach of rehabilitation incident is just the tip of an iceberg. The system has collapsed. There is no monitoring. And all these are the responsibilities of the administration. Have you really funded the operations? Is there enough monitoring? Bureau Chief, you have always looked after social welfare policies. Now you should put your hand on your heart and ask yourself whether you have discharged your responsibility. Shouldn't you be sorry for this state of affairs? And there is something we might have forgotten. We have this principle of officials accountability system. In 2002, in a electrical paper, it says that when a bureau director commits serious policy mistakes, meaning that the policy is wrongfully made, or if there are serious mistakes committed, then the bureau chief should take responsibility and step down. Do you regard this as serious mistakes, and what political responsibility should you take up? And SWD, according to the Ming Pao report, in recent times, there were 6 inmates who died abnormally. One fell from a height, one hanged himself, 2 choked to death, 1 had his wound not dressed properly, and the other one, no particular reason for death. When did you first come to know about this? What did you do in order to prevent similar serious incidents? Thank you. Mr. Wu Chi-wai? Thank you, Chairman. Like what Mr. Lam said, the breach of rehabilitation incident is just the tip of an iceberg. We have received also information about many other incidents. The administration said that in 2021, there will be the completion of many more places. But what is the target waiting time? Number 2. Talking about the mentally handicapped, they can be mildly, moderately, or severely handicapped, but they are put in integrated homes. However, the manpower requirement and service requirement for the three different levels of handicap should be different. There should be a finer division of labor. So you provide proper care for the MH who have different levels of handicap. We have heard that there is a big requirement for manpower. The bureau chief talked about training. But what is more important is the workers are under pressure. Say those who care for severely MH, it is labor intensive, and it must be more labor intensive than those who care for the mildly or moderately handicapped. But if different MH people are put in the same home, the workers may experience psychological handicap in caring for the MH who have different levels of requirement. Mr. Michael Tian. Thank you, Chair.
DSALG does different interdepartmental tasks. And the commonality for this is that all departments do not treat the able-bodied and the handicapped the same. From 1998 to 2016, in normal primary schools, the ratio is 1 to 45 to 1 to 20. And for the children with special needs, it's 1 to 8 to 1 to 6. And for the mentally handicapped, from 1998 to this year, there have been a lot of manpower for subvented hostels. It is 1 to 1.4. But here under the RCHD, it is 1 to 6.7. So it's worse than schools. The administration does not provide parity treatment for the handicapped and the non-handicapped. I hope you will redress that difference. My proposal is simple. For the severely handicapped, the per capita cost is 14,000 and 2,200 are waiting for places. If you increase places, it should be about 370 million a year. Then that can address the rental or manpower problems. And for the mildly and moderately mentally handicapped, you can buy places, you can provide subsidy in order to enforce a better ratio. And also, improper treatment of inmates. I hope there will be a requirement for CCTV to be installed in every corner, or else you will not be able to prosecute the culprits. Mr. Ray Chan, thank you, Chairman. The deputations are making accusations and also proposals. I think the bureau chief has heard them many times. I believe he has looked into them. However, the feeling you are giving the public is you say there will be more enforcement and you will not tolerate such incidents, but they remain slogans. The policy, of course, now is to enhance the retired discipline service officers and also to step up enforcement. You said you already inspected the breach of rehabilitation 20 times a year, but it has no meaning. The purpose of inspection is to improve services. If you don't do that, there is no use inspecting the home for 100 times. So I can only say that even if you have conducted inspections, you have adopted a laid-back attitude. The breach of rehabilitation may be the tip of the iceberg. And what is worse is that this may not be the worst. And there are other homes which should be closed because they are in a worse condition. You know, the inmates from the bridge home have moved out, and some of them found that their new home was even worse than the bridge home. So you don't want to see these homes close because it will mean more work and trouble for you, and that may be why you are lax in your enforcement. Well, today is not the time for such deep-seated issues. Let me talk about the deputation's aspiration. They ask you to take over the breach of rehabilitation home. I'd like to ask you whether technically there is a mechanism for you to do that. Can you really intervene and so-called take over the homes? Thank you. Mr. Holden Chow. Thank you, Chair. I have a few questions. Number one. You say you would engage retired disciplinary services officers. Can you let us know a figure and progress of the scheme? And also, in para 10, you want to step up prosecution. Let to know some prosecution figures. We heard many deputations say that prosecutions and supervision have not been seriously done. And also, Cap 613, the RCHD ordinance, the penalty is imprisonment for 2 years. It's quite lenient. And it may not serve as a good enough deterrent. Maybe you should amend the law and increase the penalty. That's all. Thank you, Mr. Chow. Ms. Elizabeth Quart. Thank you, Chair. I'd like to thank the deputations and individuals for coming. This has been a long-standing problem. Parents and families also complained to me about the operation of such homes. And we have reflected the views to the Bureau and the Department, but unfortunately, I haven't seen a comprehensive plan to tackle the inadequacy of homes and inadequacy of manpower and also poor management problems. And families have nowhere to turn to. They are really in a very sad situation. I believe the Bureau Chief can feel that. The breach of rehabilitation is just the tip of an iceberg, and it serves to detonate this problem for society. I think you cannot shirk your responsibility anymore. You cannot duck the problem anymore. You must find a way to make an overhaul of the system to help families face these long-standing problems. I'm particularly concerned about the sexual offense problem. Sexual violence and sexual offenses particularly harm the mentally handicapped, and is unacceptable. Therefore, deputations have said that there should be a licensing condition to require declaration or disclosure of sexual offenses, and that people who have a conviction record of sexual offenses should be put on a register, etc. The Bureau should consider this. Thank you, Ms. Quart. We still have Lam Kwok Hong and Eunice Yong. We will then have to take care of the motion, and in fact, we are overrun. Ms. Eunice Yong. A lot of repercussion has resulted from the breach of rehabilitation incident. Now, I have certain views. In terms of the gathering of evidence, can the DOJ only decide on prosecution or not on the basis of a normal witness? In 1993, and the victim in another case was too affected to give a statement, and also the culprit therefore was released. And then Mr. Justice Wong Kin Chiao proposed that the victim of criminal offenses will not be so affected. Therefore, there was a reform proposal to help vulnerable witnesses. This will also help the mentally handicapped victims to ensure that there will be a fair trial for them. I'd like to ask the DOJ, when you decided to withdraw prosecution, did you consider that other mechanism? And also, when you withdraw prosecution about these cases, I'd like to know the numbers. And also, for such vulnerable witnesses, have you made a separate prosecution code? Can you let us know about it? And if there is none, can you review the situation and submit a report? Mr. Lam Kwok Hong? Chairman, we know that the CE will not go to Beijing. He will stay in Hong Kong to watch over the JR case. CY Leung, of course, said a number of things when he ran for the post, and he said he cared a lot about the welfare of the elderly and the disadvantaged. So much has happened recently. The administration is in a difficult position because whether it be the elderly, the disabled, or the mentally handicapped, there is a lack of homes for them. And that is why private homes have started the operation. Therefore, I think the question is, if you really want to do something, he should come here. Since he is in Hong Kong, he should come to this meeting, because I don't know whether Matthew Cheung is bold enough to relate these views to him. The administration should set up one important organ like the ICAC to give it all the powers it needs to tackle these problems. There is a lack of government homes, and private homes are taking in the quota, not looked after by government homes. Mr. Zheng would say it's difficult to find land. We also want to build homes. Then let us have a commissioner to look after it, so we don't have to go through so many bureaus and departments. It's HAD or LWB or THB. If you really want to do something, please, let us have an ICAC-like organ. Why did we have the ICAC? It's because there was a rampant corruption problem. Now, if you can't tackle these home problems, let us have a commission.
Let's deal with the motion. Can Dr. Fernando Cheung walk us through the motion, please? I would read it out, Chairman, and I hope members would support it. In recent years, at the Bridge of Rehabilitation, there were a series of sexual assaults and as well as mysterious deaths by inmates, and this reveals the poor quality of private RCHDs. We urge the government to convene an interdisciplinary committee that includes users and reform the entire elderly and PWD care home system. And the relevant ordinances must be reviewed within 3 years. The manpower ratio must be enhanced, as well as the environment. Penalties should be reinforced, and there should be more requirements on operators. And the SWD should have the power to take over care homes. The government should also step up monitoring, take over poor private homes, and based on the UN conventions, they should replan long-term care services, develop multilateral homes, and step up services in order to offer dignity to PWDs and frail elderly. Do panel members agree with this motion? Please raise your hands if you do. So this, we have a unanimous decision. Let's take a 5-minute break before we start the second session. I'd like to thank the deputations and individuals for attending the session. Thank you very much.